Assalamu alaikum everyone. So I'm back with another video, and that is on another very important topic, that is preparation of salts. We've already talked about some basics about salt, that how are they formed. They are formed when metal hits the negative ion of the acid. You can also visualize it something like this. For example, if you replace hydrogen of an acid with any metal, a salt is formed. For example, if I replace it with sodium, then NaCl is formed. If I replace it with calcium, then calcium chloride is formed. If I replace it with lead, then lead chloride is formed. Okay, so you can actually visualize by both ways. The salt is formed when the hydrogen of an acid is replaced by a metal, or a salt is formed when metal hits the negative ion of the acid. It's the same point, the same things are happening. We're just looking at it from different perspectives. So as far as salts are concerned, you need to remember some rules of solubility, which will tell you that which salt is soluble in water and which salt is insoluble in water. And it's going to help you not only making in actually knowing which salt is in preparing salts, it will also help you in actually deducing that where are you going to write aqueous in chemical equations and where are you going to write solids in chemical equations. For example, if you are writing soluble salts, then you are going to write aqueous in it. If you are writing insoluble salt, then you are going to write solid with it. Okay. So what are the rules of solubility? There are four classes of compounds. There are four classes of salts that you need to study. There are nitrates, chlorides, sulfates and carbonates. So all nitrates are soluble in water, which means you take any nitrate, be it sodium nitrate, calcium nitrate, barium nitrate, lead nitrate, all are going to be soluble in water. Then most chlorides are soluble in water. Most chlorides are soluble in water except small, medium, large. Small, medium, large. S for silver chloride, M for mercury chloride, L for lead chloride. Most sulfates are soluble in water except for calcium sulfate, barium sulfate and lead sulfate. You can remember it like PASO, BASO and PASO. I know it sounds a bit weird, but it's easier to remember this way. That's how I remembered it. That's how I memorized it. Most sulfates are soluble in water except CASO, BASO and PASO. And most carbonates are insoluble in water. Now this is different. Normally all the three classes of salts that we have just discussed, are most of them are soluble in water. But carbonates, most carbonates are insoluble in water except Army Public School, APS, ammonium, potassium and sodium. These three carbonates are soluble in water, and other rest of the carbonates are insoluble in water. Now we are going to talk about preparation of different kinds of salt. The first one comes to mind is the preparation of insoluble salts. How would you prepare an insoluble salt? Now, let's say you're making an insoluble salt, that is silver chloride, from silver nitrate. You're making silver chloride from silver nitrate. Silver chloride is an insoluble salt. Okay? And how do you make it? Now you need to introduce Cl instead of nitrate. So you would add an appropriate acid to it. Which acid would it be? You will add HCl to AgNO3 and you will mix them well. That would be the first step to prepare the salt. Once you added HCl, you prepared the solution of silver chloride. Now silver chloride is insoluble. Now if you want to separate an insoluble substance from a solution, you will have to filter it. Then you will filter the insoluble precipitates of silver chloride. Okay. After that, obviously silver chloride will have some silver nitrate on it as well. Then you will wash the precipitates of silver chloride with distilled water. Wash the precipitates with distilled water. Okay, how do we do that? You simply pour water over the filter paper, and water will pass through the filter paper, and the silver chloride precipitates and silver chloride precipitates will be all washed out. Okay. Now, since they are washed, so they'll be wet, so they'll have to be dried. So you'll dry the crystals between folds of filter paper, or you can also dry the crystals in a warm oven. So these will be the four steps that you should know for preparing insoluble salts. Let's take another example. Let's say if you, I want to prepare calcium sulfate, which is an insoluble salt, from calcium chloride. Okay, what would you do here? Here you need to just change the acid. You need to introduce sulfate, so you have to add sulfuric acid to calcium chloride. And the rest of the steps are going to remain the same. You'll have to filter the insoluble precipitates of, in this case, you'll have to filter the insoluble precipitates of calcium sulfate. Okay. Once you've done that, you will wash the precipitates of calcium sulfate with distilled water. And the fourth point would be dry the crystals between the folds of the filter paper or in a warm oven. So that's how you prepare insoluble salts. Now let's talk about how do you prepare soluble salts. See, the thing is that soluble salts can be prepared by two methods. Okay, one method is you are preparing a soluble salt from an insoluble starting material, and the other method is you are preparing a soluble salt from a soluble starting material. Insoluble starting materials can be metal oxides or metals, and soluble starting material is metal hydroxides. Both involve different methods. If you're using an insoluble starting material to prepare a soluble salt, you will use an excess method. And if you're using a soluble starting material to prepare a soluble salt, then you will be using titration method. Just remember, and these insoluble, these are the only things, these are the only starting materials that you're going to come across to prepare soluble salts. Okay, metal and metal oxide. And metal hydroxides are the only soluble starting materials that you're going to encounter to prepare soluble salts. Now, let's discuss what is excess method. Let's discuss what is excess method. Now, let's say I need to prepare iron sulfate from iron powder. Now, I need to introduce sulfate. You are making a soluble salt from an insoluble starting material. You will add sulfuric acid. Now, the first step would be add iron to sulfuric acid until it is in excess. Now, why do we need to dissolve iron in excess? We need to discuss that. The thing is that we need some indication that the reaction is complete. And that's how we get it. We add the insoluble starting material in excess. Now, let me elaborate on this point. Let's say I have a beaker of, let's say, H2SO4, and I added some iron into it. It got disappeared. The only reason it can disappear is that if it is reacting with H2SO4. If it was not reacting, it would have settled down because it is insoluble. Then I added another spoon of iron powder and it got disappeared as well. Okay. Then I added a third spoon of iron. It did not disappear. It started to settle at the bottom. It showed me that all the H2SO4 is consumed. Okay. And the reaction is complete. Okay. So the point of adding excess is to ensure that the reaction is complete. So that's why the method is called excess method, and that's why you add the insoluble substance in excess so that it can indicate you that the reaction is complete. So the first step would be to add the insoluble starting material to a suitable acid until it is in excess. Then you will have to filter the excess insoluble starting material. In this case is iron. You have to filter the excess iron. Once you have filtered it, you are left with a soluble salt solution. And how do you separate a soluble salt from the solution? You simply evaporate the solution to crystallization point. And when you evaporate solution to crystallization point, the volume of water will reduce to half or more. And then you can simply dry the crystals in warm oven and you will get the dry crystals. Which crystals? You have to mention it. You'll get the iron sulfate crystals in warm oven. You have to dry the iron sulfate crystals in warm oven to get dry crystals. Okay. Now let's do another example. Let's say I have to prepare magnesium sulfate from magnesium oxide. Now it's a metal oxide. Again, it is a non-metal. It is an insoluble starting material to prepare a soluble salt. So you will be using excess method. Okay, what would the first step? You will add MgO to H2SO4 until it is in excess. Then you will filter the excess MgO. And then you will evaporate the magnesium sulfate solution to crystallization point, and then you will dry the crystals in warm oven or between the folds of filter paper. Okay, this was the excess method. Now let's talk about titration method. See, titration method is used to, the thing is that when you're using a soluble starting material, for example, if I'm using a metal hydroxide, right, I need to prepare potassium chloride from potassium hydroxide. Now, since it is soluble, it is not going to settle down once all the HCl is consumed because it is soluble. So there is nothing to indicate us that the reaction is complete, that all the acid is consumed. So to actually know that the reaction is complete, we actually use the titration method. But first we need to know what exactly is titration. What exactly is titration? This is the basic apparatus of the titration method. Titration that you're going to study in O levels is primarily acid-based titration. Acid-based titration. What is the concept of titration? Titration is the technique that is used to calculate the concentration of an unknown solution using the concentration of a known solution. Okay, known solution is usually put in the burette. This is the burette. Okay, and the unknown solution is put in the conical flask, which is also known as the titration flask. And you also have add the indicator here. Okay, now how would that connect? How would that connect to preparation of salt here? Now let's see. Okay, let's say HCl was the known solution, I put it in the burette, and KOH was the unknown solution, I put it in the titration flask, and then I added an indicator. An indicator showed the color it shows in the alkaline solution. Okay, let's say if I added methyl orange, that the color would be the alkaline solution, the color would be yellow. Okay, now what would happen? What happens is that when I started adding HCl, okay, when I start adding HCl, the pH is going to reduce. pH is going to reduce. Let me just remove it and write it again. Yeah. Okay. So when I opened this tab and HCl started to be added drop by drop into the KOH solution, pH of the solution will decrease. Why? Because right now the pH of the solution is in the alkaline or basic spectrum, which is greater than 7. Right? An indicator is showing its color respectively. When you add acid, the pH starts to reduce. Let's say initially the pH of potassium hydroxide was 11. Okay, when you added, when you started adding acid, it will reduce to 9, then 8. There will come a point that it comes to 7. 7 means that the reaction is complete because it is a neutralization reaction. Alkali is reacting with an acid. So the end point of a neutralization reaction, how would you know that a neutralization reaction is complete? The pH will reach 7. The value of pH will be equal to 7. Okay, but the problem is that at pH 7, indicator will not show any change of color, because for indicator to change color, pH has to reduce even further. So what do we do? We keep on adding. We still don't know actually. We still don't know. We keep on adding it. We don't know that the pH has reached 7. We would never know that. We only know that the reaction is complete once the indicator changes color. Okay? Because indicator changes color when pH decreases from 7 and enters the spectrum of the acid. An indicator will show the color that it shows in the acid. Then we'll know that the acid we have added is in excess now and the reaction is complete. And the reaction is complete. So that is the whole point of the indicator. It will tell you that the reaction is complete by changing its color. Obviously, you will end up adding more HCl than required, but that is the compromise here. Okay, so that's why we use titration method for preparing soluble salts using metal hydroxides. Okay, so the first step would be, what would you write? You will add HCl to KOH. You will add HCl to KOH in titration flask in the presence of an indicator to find endpoint. That would be the first step. To find endpoint, endpoint is the point at which indicator changes color. Then you will repeat titration without indicator. We repeat titrations multiple times because there is a high chance of human error. Okay, and we get the best results after repeating titrations 2 or 3 times. Okay, because you are going to operate this tap. It depends that how much volume of ACL do you let it go, because poor titration results are obtained when you open the tap too much and a large volume of ACL goes into the a large volume of ACL goes into the solution of AOH at once. Okay, because if a large volume goes here, so there's a high possibility that pH reduces drastically and you miss the endpoint, and you actually miss the endpoint, and you end up adding more ACL than required. So it is always recommended that you add, you open the tap such that the ACL just trickles down into the titration flask, so that you don't end up adding more than 2 or 3 drops, okay, in the KOH solution, or here the salt will be formed in the salt solution. Okay, so you repeat titrations to actually shortlist the best readings, and the best readings will be the ones which have the least volumes, which have the least volume, and volumes will be what? The initial volume and the final volume, the volumes of the HCl here. Okay, so these will be the first two steps. Now you added. The first step was you mixed the acid to an alkali in titration flask in the presence of an indicator to find endpoint, and then you repeated titration without indicator. Now you have the salt solution, which is the soluble salt. You will again repeat the same steps. Heat the KCl solution to crystallization point, and then you will dry the crystals in warm oven. Okay. Now let's say if you want to prepare sodium sulfate from NaOH. Again, the method is going to remain the same. Again, this time you will add H2SO4, you will add H2SO4 to NaOH in titration flask in the presence of an indicator to find endpoint. Then you will repeat titration without indicator, and then you will have the sodium sulfate solution. It's a soluble salt. You will evaporate the solution to crystallization point, and then you will dry the crystals in warm oven. Okay. Now these are a bit straightforward. Just remember that, for example, if these are 4 points, and there's high possibility that you're going to get a 4-mark question for this, right? But it is equally likely that they may not give you a 4-mark question. Instead, they give you, let's say, a 3-mark question or a 2-mark question, and they add ACID themselves, and they actually mention the first two steps themselves. Okay, and then you just need to write the next two steps. They do that to check your concepts, because if you start from the scratch, they would know that you actually don't have any idea what the question is talking about. You just have memorized these points. So be very careful about it. Okay, now one thing that I need to tell you, another thing is that in some cases you need to prepare, let's say, ammonium sulfate. You would need to prepare ammonium salts. Ammonium sulfate. Okay, that's a soluble salt. Obviously, let's say the starting material is H2SO4, he has told you that. How would you add ammonium? You would have to add aqueous ammonia. And remember, aqueous ammonia is actually a hydroxide. When ammonia is dissolved in water, NH4 ions and hydroxide ions are released. So you are going to, whenever you're preparing an ammonium salt from ammonia, remember that you're going to use titration method. Okay, titration method. And the first step would be, you will add aqueous ammonia to H2SO4 in titration flask in the presence of an indicator to find endpoint. Then you'll repeat the titration, and then you will have this solution, and you'll evaporate this ammonium sulfate solution to crystallization point, and then you'll dry the crystals in warm oven. So these were the concepts that were associated with salts, preparation of salts. Now we are going to discuss some past papers related to the chapter. Okay, so question number one. Group 1 metals form compounds with group 7 halogens. The compounds formed are dash and water and contain dash bonds. Group 1 metals will always form ionic bonds. So it will either be B or D. Okay, so group 1 metal, let's take a group 1 metal. I'm taking sodium. Let's take a group 7 halogen. The most common is fluorine. And they will form NaCl, and which is soluble in water. So the answer would be D. Okay. Now, which pair of substances can be used to prepare a sample of lead chloride when added to water and mixed. Okay, so you are looking to prepare an insoluble salt, and I told you that you need to know that whenever you're preparing an insoluble salt, you will always prepare it from a soluble salt. You'll always prepare from a soluble salt, because if you are using an insoluble salt to prepare an insoluble salt, there is high chance of them mixing together. Let's say if you are using A to form B, B is insoluble and A is also insoluble. Okay, then A started reacting with an acid and B started to form. It is happening in the same solution. So it is highly likely that A gets mixed to B, because both are insoluble. And the problem is not the mixing. Problem is that you won't be able to separate them. If you're using insoluble salt to prepare prepare an insoluble salt, always remember that whenever you are required to prepare an insoluble salt, you will always use a soluble starting material. Both soluble starting materials, both the materials, acids are anyway soluble, and the salt that you are taking, you have to make sure it has to be a soluble salt so that it doesn't get mixed with the insoluble salt. So lead is insoluble, it can't be the answer. Lead carbonate is insoluble, lead is insoluble. The answer would be B for this reason. So question number 4, which substance is insoluble in water? Ammonium carbonate is soluble, ammonium nitrate is soluble, calcium carbonate is insoluble. This I used rules of solubility to solve this. Which process is used in the preparation of soluble salts? Evaporation. Precipitation is used in the preparation of insoluble salts, because precipitates are formed in insoluble salts. What is the correct sequence for obtaining pure salt from a mixture of sand and salt? First thing is, you will add water. When you add water, salt will dissolve, sand will not, and then you'll filter to separate sand, and then you'll evaporate to separate water. So filter, add water, filter and evaporate. Answer would be C. The table shows the solubility of some compounds of metal Q in cold water. So metal Q, carbonate is insoluble, fluoride is soluble, sulfate is insoluble. Let's take barium. Now barium's carbonate is insoluble, barium's chloride is soluble, and barium sulfate is insoluble. The answer would be barium. Which acid and base react together to produce an insoluble salt? Insoluble salt. This will form sodium chloride. This will form calcium nitrate. This will form barium sulfate. The answer would be C. Barium sulfate is insoluble. A student mixed together aqueous solution of Y and Z. A white precipitate is formed. What could not be the solutions of Y and Z? Whatever the solutions, what could not be the solutions of Y and Z? Those will be the solutions which will not form precipitates. Which will not form precipitates. Okay, because Y and Z form precipitates. So what could not be the solutions of Y and Z? They will not form precipitates. Silver chloride, silver will react with Cl. Silver chloride forms precipitates. This can't be the answer. Sodium will react with HCl, NaCl, and HNO3 will be formed, so it will not form any precipitate. The answer would be B. Which metal has a soluble carbonate, chloride, and sulfate? Barium sulfate is, and carbonate is insoluble, so it can't be the answer. Calcium sulfate is also insoluble, can't be the answer. Copper carbonate is insoluble as well, can't be the answer. Potassium carbonate is soluble, potassium chloride is soluble, potassium sulfate is soluble. So D would be the answer. Okay, let's do this question. Write an ionic equation for the reaction between acid and alkali. What are you? Acids are neutralized by alkalis. Ionic equation are going to remain the same. Hydrogen ion and hydroxide ion will react together to form water. So name a sodium compound and the acid that can be used to make sodium sulfate. So you can use sodium hydroxide to produce sodium. Okay. Whenever you just remember, for example, you're about to make sodium sulfate. So if you have to introduce a metal Remember that you'll always introduce a metal hydroxide because it is applicable in most of the questions. Now, for example, let me elaborate on it. You want to prepare sodium sulfate. Let's say he hasn't told you in this case as well that from where sodium is coming from. You have to choose yourself. The sulfate is pretty simple, H2SO4. There's no other option. But sodium can be introduced by introducing sodium metal or sodium oxide or sodium hydroxide or sodium carbonate, because in all the cases sodium sulfate will be formed. But whenever you have to introduce the metal, like in this case, always remember that it is safer to introduce its hydroxide. Always remember, it is much safer to. I don't want to go deeper into it. Just remember that whenever you don't know the starting material of a salt, as in from the metal side, you don't know the starting material, always introduce the metal's hydroxide. As a result, you will always be using titration method. Like in this case, you need to prepare sodium sulfate. So sodium compound would be sodium hydroxide, and the acid that you'll be using is the sulfuric acid. Remember that you're not supposed to write chemical formulas here. They asked you to name the compounds. Okay, you cannot write NaOH and H2SO4 here. Be very careful. Describe how the titration method is used to prepare a colorless solution of sodium sulfate. So you can add. Well, you don't know here that whether sulfuric acid is known or sodium hydroxide is known. So you can just say that add H2SO4 to sodium hydroxide. Add H2SO4 to sodium hydroxide in a titration flask. In a titration flask using a burette. Okay. Then you can say, you can also tell them, like I actually wrote one point while we were explaining it to you, that add H2SO4 to N2 NaOH in a titration flask in the presence of an indicator to find endpoint. Right? So you can also add it here. Titration flask using a burette in the presence of an indicator to find endpoint. Okay, then you can repeat the titration without indicator. There you go. I was splitting it into 3 points. You can split it into 3 points so that you can get 3 marks. Okay. You need to remember here that he's asking you to prepare a solution of sodium sulfate, right? He's not asking you to prepare pure crystals. So that's why be very careful. Do not write the solution to crystallization point here. Do not. Okay, you have to stop here. Okay. Then here, the next part of the question is actually the next 2 points will come here. How pure sodium sulfate crystals can be made from aqueous sodium sulfate? So, we'll heat the sodium sulfate solution to crystallization point. Heat the sodium sulfate solution to crystallization point. And then you can try the crystals between the folds of the filter paper. Try the crystals between folds of filter paper. Get 2 marks for this. Okay, so this is a P2 type question. So another question is, how a pure sample of magnesium chloride can be made from magnesium? Now, magnesium chloride is a soluble salt. You're preparing it from an insoluble starting material. You're going to use excess method here. So the first step would be add magnesium to HCl until it is in excess. Filter the excess magnesium, then you will simply evaporate the magnesium chloride solution crystallization point and dry the crystals in warm. I'm not writing it, so I hope that you have already gotten the gist of it. Okay, this is a rather decent question. So the question shows the reaction of methanol with HCl. The progress of this reaction can be followed by taking small samples of HCl of the reaction mixture every hour and determining the concentration of HCl. How would you determine the concentration of HCl? You can determine the concentration of HCl by titration, like I told you while explaining titration. That titration is actually used to calculate the concentration of an unknown solution by using the concentration of a known solution. So you will use titration. So you can simply say that you will titrate HCl with an alkali, for example, NaOH liquid saturation. I will titrate HCl with an alkali. Okay. Place HCl in titration flask. In this case, since they have told you that HCl is unknown, so put HCl in titration flask and alkali in in burette. Okay. This must be the first point. Sorry, this must be the second one. Okay, and the third one, you can also write the add indicator in the titration flask. Okay, so you get 3 marks. Better sequence would be to place HCl in titration flask and alkali in burette, then titrate HCl with an alkali, then add indicator in the titration flask, and you will be able to find what you're looking for. Describe how a pure sample of ammonium nitrate can be prepared from nitric acid. You are looking to prepare ammonium nitrate from nitric acid. I gave you this example. Here you'll have to add aqueous ammonia. And aqueous ammonia is actually a hydroxide, a soluble substance, soluble starting material. So you'll be using titration. So the first step would be add aqueous ammonia to nitric acid in a titration flask in the presence of an indicator to find endpoint. Repeat titration without indicator to find acid, and then let the 2 marks and the rest of the 2 will come from heat the solution to crystallization point and dry the crystal between folds of filter paper. All four points will come here because you need to prepare pure sample, and this is a 4 mark question. So that will be all from this chapter. I hope I have made your life a bit easier as far as salts are concerned. I'll be back with another video. Stay tuned. Until then, Allah Hafiz.